He might just look at me and be like, "इसे हो पाएगा क्या?" Whatever he may not be, he
Love
has that
that.
like mad Mumbai
It's a
energy, you
great
know, ensemble cast. And I'm like, getting this cast to tell this not
story.
superfluous or frivolous. It
Right.
was like, you know, really about the drama of this situation.
Hello and welcome to Binge Buddies. In today's episode of Candid Conversation, we are speaking with the actor, writer and singer Suhas Ahuja. Before we proceed, do not forget to subscribe to Binge Buddies. Welcome to Binge Buddies, Suhas. Thank you so much for taking out the time.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Firstly, many, many, many congratulations on a very hit show, The Married Woman. And I read about today morning itself that it has been officially renewed for season two as well.
Yeah, I don't know. I read that article too, you know. I mean, I don't know how like official it is. I mean, it seems like they're quoting, you know, Ekta Kapoor only.
Yeah. Yeah.
But who knows these things, man? You know, like, I'm so happy to do like so much hearsay, especially for something like The Married Woman.
Yeah. First and foremost, I want to ask you very honestly. So I read about the whole process, and it was from the day one of your audition for a particular role in this series and the day one of shoot, there was a gap of, let's say, 12, 13 months roughly. And by the time it got all finalized and you start shooting for the series, tell me one
thing. About 20 months, maybe.
Wow. So it's more than 1.5 years. That's a long, long time.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
Wow.
I mean, I can't be like precise, but I think it was like, you know, we started shooting in what, October 2020.
Uh-huh.
And I think I auditioned first for it around June, July 2018.
Wow. So this is all pre-lockdown and the prep started.
I actually got confirmed for the show only about 17 days before we were supposed to start shooting.
Wow.
So like I had done my initial audition like say 2 years before or whatever.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then there were huge periods of just like, oh, I did something, forget about it, you know, whatever, I haven't heard back and all that. And then I would get another call saying, hey, remember you did this, we'd like you to do one more thing.
Okay.
And that sort of like went on like that. But then finally, I was locked like, you know, I was locked. And then the following day or the 2 days later, I was going to be in my first script read.
Wow.
You know, it was like that.
Yeah.
You know? It's quite, and I don't really know how or why that happened, like how... I was like locked so late, but you know, I'm not, I'll take that. It's fine.
But that's right. It just happened for the good, I would say. Lovely.
Yeah, yeah.
When you were going through the whole filming process, did you expect the show to get this amount of love and response from the audience globally?
Yeah, Uriya, I have to say that there were many stages through this whole process where this show kept taking me by surprise, you know? Even through the audition process, the scenes that I was being given, they were like, it was genuine drama, you know, it was not superfluous or frivolous.
Right.
It was like, you know, really about the drama of the situation.
Yeah.
I was like, okay, well, that's great. You know, that's the right way to deal with such content.
Yeah.
Moving on, then the script reads happen and I'm at the script reads and what I'm reading is, it's, you know, it's pretty nice off the page. And I'm getting to hear from Sahir, our director, about how like they've been working on the scripts for a really long time, like over a year, and lots of rewrites, and Ekta Kapoor coming in with her ideas, you know. Then we started shooting and I'm looking at all these actors around me. And I'm looking at how good they are, how fantastic they are. And like, it's a great ensemble cast. And I'm like, getting this cast to tell this story is like, you know, so at each point, there was like something making a difference and a very positive like difference.
Yeah.
And, you know, putting all these like little, very positive elements together, like lots of rewriting, good director, good cast, and this and that.
Yeah.
And then it comes together and then all these good people know only one way of doing their work and, you know, putting it together. And then when they do that, the end product is like really special. So then, even so, during the shoot, all these scenes were coming alive. You know, my family scenes with Riddhi, who's fantastic, and then Rahul Bora and, you know, Nadira Babbar, and they're just like fantastic actors, and all these scenes are just coming alive. And I'm like, you know, I'm doing my work in front of the camera, and I'm like, this is great, you know, what is happening here is very nice. And everybody was feeling that way. And as we went forward, I think it took everybody by surprise that like what was coming together was, you know, a quality, I think, fair to say, was higher than what people were expecting, even of themselves.
So going through that process in that moment itself, there was a moment of creative satisfaction that, oh, whatever is happening right now is really good. I'm really going back satisfied from my end of the day.
Hugely. I mean, like that's, you know, it's a feeling that you want every day of your life.
Right.
And to have that, you know, going to work and coming back being like, all right, you know, that's great. You know, good day of work. That's just like... That's really special, really special. And, you know, I'm very glad that happened.
Amazing. Now, talking about the season two, I definitely see there is a possibility of story going forward, because the closure is not like a hard closure on the season one last episode. So it's pretty much open, but not very open-ended.
The last line of the show is my character, Hemant.
Right.
Calling her, she finishes her whole like into camera narration and all that, and then it goes to black, and he says, "Asa meri shirt ka hai," you know,
exactly,
and that's the ending of the entire show. And you know, and this is actually, again, this is all credit to Ekta Kapoor, who had this idea like very, very last minute, and she said, "Well, you know, don't I just get this audio recorded and let's put it in." And so it was her idea, and that happened kind of last minute. Wow. But if you think about it, it's a very bleak ending.
Yeah,
it's a very bleak ending to a show that's about so much about hope and love and the power of love.
Yeah.
So I think, you know, on that aspect, you definitely would want a second season,
right?
Just to undo that bleakness or give a reward, something like that, you know.
I came across multiple posts online, of course, being tagged for the show and etc. Did you or did any other fans of the show reach out to you via social media, sharing a couple of their own stories or sharing that how they related to the show?
Yes, there have been quite a few people who've like, you know, written like directly to me on like Instagram and stuff. Where they, you know, most of it is like congratulatory, but there've been a couple of like actual stories, you know, and this is very early on. I think 2 or 3 days after the show started airing, that you know, someone wrote to me and said like that, you know, started talking about Indian men, and I made a response. I said, yeah, you know. She said something about like the way I acted as the Indian man or whatever. I said, thank you and all that. And then she said, told me about like, you know, she having left her husband like, you know, 10 years ago or something. And so, you know, I mean, it just resonates so strongly.
Exactly.
You know?
Yeah. Definitely. Yeah. That is something. A show having this kind of impact goes to show that it served its purpose. People definitely loved it. Even if there is an X percentage of audience which relates to the content, I think it's more than enough, because then they become the loyal fans of that particular content right away.
Yeah.
So that's the best part about it. Amazing. Now, if I'm not mistaken, you have been part of the show Indian Telly, which is Kyunki Saas Bhi Kabhi Bahuti, the very famous one. And you've worked with the Balaji Telefilms in the past as well. How has the day on the set of Balaji Telefilms changed, you feel, over the years?
They can't be compared. All Balaji and Balaji Telefilms are completely different beasts with completely different natures. In fact, during the promotions of The Married Woman, which is an All Balaji show, Riddhi and I went over to the set of a Balaji Telefilm show called Kundali Bhagya. And we did this sort of like crossover episode sort of thing for marketing. And it was completely different. The atmosphere, the, you know, the setup of the set on that day was completely different. I mean, time is the utmost concern in like Balaji Telefilms or in like, you know, any daily soap.
Yeah.
But when you're doing OTT, then quality is of the essence, you know? So you will do those retakes again and again if you're looking for something.
Right.
But on a daily show, it, you get maybe like two chances. two chances to, like, you know, do
give that
whatever you can, do the best you can.
Yeah.
And in fact, like, there's a multiple camera setup. There's like four cameras from, you know, everywhere. So you actually do a whole scene, you do it in like minutes.
Right.
Whereas you would like probably spend a whole day doing one scene for an OTT show, or like, you know, or maybe half a day.
Is it correct to say the process for an actor per se on a set on the daily soap is much more hectic compared to on OTT or a film, because the process is different?
Well, I mean, it is definitely more hectic. But you know, a lot of actors, in fact, Riddhi and I, that day we were talking about it, and we were expressing our admiration for being on the set of a daily show. And we were talking about how there's nothing like working on a daily show that trains you, you know, in terms of your training.
Right.
You're given a scene, which is, it's like a 4 pages long, and you have 4 pages of lines.
Yeah.
And you have to like shoot in 45 minutes.
Right.
While you're eating lunch, you know, sometimes that can be the case.
Right.
I mean, can you imagine, you know? And then so it's all you're directing yourself,
right.
You're even like tweaking the lines yourself,
right.
You know, because you're in charge of that character. So
exactly.
Then you get this like material, and you're preparing, and you want to do your best. Like, those actors taking that so professionally, and I mean, it is, they're going for glory.
Right.
It's not like 45 minutes. Like do a you know, half decent job, director okay kar dega, you can go home and
right.
like cash your check. Not that at all.
Right.
You know, they are going for glory.
Right.
And I mean, being able to do that, it's also exhilarating, you know.
Mm-hmm.
It's a very different kind of brush.
Perfect. Now, you have been exposed to theater and art since your childhood. If I read correctly, your parents have been heavily involved in the art, which is writing, acting, directing. Now,
parents are originally theater people.
Oh, yeah.
They met in the Delhi theater scene as actors. And etc.
Oh, that's amazing.
Lots of theater all my life. Yeah.
Lovely. So do you think you would have ended up being an artist even if you didn't have parents who were into this profession?
I don't know. I mean, like, even though I had parents in this profession, going to a very rigorous academic school for most of my life, I think around like ninth standard, my plan was, I'll graduate and take science in 11th and do, you know, go to IIT and do an MBA and like, rule the FMCG industry, you know. I mean, that was kind of like what everybody was thinking. And because like my parents do what they do, there was always this like, it was much easier because my mom was writing directing, a professional writer director. So then like, there's no, you know, I don't have to fight that fight to be a writer director myself, you know? Definitely having them as parents made a difference. Would I have still done the same thing? I don't know, and maybe not.
Great. Now, you've spent a large part of your life in Chennai. Now, if you could point out anything, like, you know, three things which Chennai taught you, and then after moving to Mumbai, you feel like, okay, this is what is different from Chennai and Mumbai taught you at that age.
So I don't know about three things, but Chennai is like, you know, a much smaller place. At least the Chennai that I grew up in comparison with the Mumbai that would have been the Mumbai, which was, around the time I was growing up. So Mumbai was already a very like big, vibrant metropolitan city.
Yeah.
You know, Chennai was the city, you know, where like the big city in like Tamil Nadu, the Madras Presidency, you know, Tamil culture is like has a lot more like humility and like peacefulness within like the interpersonal interactions, you know, on the street, at the shop, you know, it's like calmer,
right.
You know, it's more grounded.
Right.
And it's very different in Mumbai, what they call like, you know, the street smart. Mumbai is all about the street smart. So you know, Chennai is very different that way.
Right.
And being like sort of smaller in terms of number of people, in terms of like social circles.
Yeah.
You know, in Chennai, we grew up and everybody knew everyone.
Right.
You know, everybody knew everyone.
Yeah.
As you got older and older, everybody knew everyone, you know.
Yeah.
You knew everybody at a party, you know. In Chennai,
yeah.
It'd be like 200 people, but you know all of them.
Yeah.
You know. I loved that, like, mad Mumbai energy, you know.
Okay.
It's like in Mumbai, it's like it's a torrential stream and you fall into it and Mumbai life is like sweeps you, you know. And it's very hard to live otherwise in Mumbai. And people who manage it, they have to like do a lot of things to manage it. They have to have a balcony with plants and,
exactly.
and a secure location or something to like make time stand still.
Yeah.
Otherwise, like time doesn't stand still in Mumbai ever.
Absolutely.
And I loved it actually because I sort of may have like Chennai, you know, after coming back from college and trying to make a career.
Uh-huh.
And I wanted originally to make a career for myself in Chennai.
Okay.
But then the opportunities were so like, you know, limited in a sense.
Mm-hmm.
That was like, why would you not move to the center, to the heart of the industry, which is Bombay?
Yeah.
It's like, you know, this may be a bad example, but like you live in Little Rock, Arkansas, and, you know, instead of moving to like LA, you know, to be a filmmaker.
Yeah.
So it was kind of like you would have to do it. So I had to come to Bombay.
Yeah.
And I love Bombay. Bombay is, for me, the best place to live in the country.
Being from Chennai, living in Mumbai, I don't know how much you follow IPL, but which is your favorite team? Whom do you root for?
Not really have a favorite. My sentimental favorite is KL Rahul. He's like my favorite. I'm always rooting for him. So I think he's with Kings 11 Punjab.
No.
So, you know, I want Kings 11 Punjab to do well. I'm also Punjabi. So I'm a Punjabi from Chennai. I'm Punjabi born, brought up in Chennai.
Wow.
So then that makes me happy. I'm happy for Delhi because lots of family is from Delhi. I just, you know, it's just, I'm very happy to be
genuinely
very pan-Indian.
Have that pan-India connection. So the loyalty will move around. That's fair enough.
And then it becomes about the cricket, you know,
that
who's actually playing good cricket.
Absolutely. I was about to mention that eventually it comes down to our domestic and international playing performing better than international player is all we want to see at the end of the day. That's the expectation.
No, not that also. I'm happy to see international cricketers do well. Sam Curran's innings the other day was just sensational.
Oh my God.
I was like, if Sam Curran wins this, I'd be very happy for Sam Curran. I don't care about England and all that.
Absolutely.
Sam Curran deserves to win.
And what are innings? I absolutely agree with you. 100% there.
Mm-hmm.
Now, not many people know you're also a songwriter and lyricist. And also you have a band and you perform gigs on a regular basis. How did this come about?
Well, I've been playing guitar like since I was about 15 years old. So that's like almost like, you know, I'm about 28 years or something now.
Okay.
And songwriting was very much like sort of intertwined with my playing guitar. If I would learn three chords,
uh-huh.
I would end up writing a song with those three chords. And you know, if
right.
I would learn like four more chords another day,
uh-huh.
then I was writing a song including those four
right.
chords.
Yeah.
So it just kind of was very natural that way for me, songwriting.
Mm-hmm.
And it was something that like I always wanted to do. And my job before Talash was actually as a full-time composer. When I was working with, guys like Naren Chandavarkar and Benedict Taylor.
Uh-huh.
And these guys who have gone on to have like wonderful music careers.
Right.
But I was composing with them for a bit. Mm-hmm. And it was like, my plan at that point of time was to like do my songs.
Okay.
And then I realized that like working as a composer,
mm-hmm.
you're just going from job to job. And it's a different game if you want to like be your own songwriter, you
right.
know?
Right.
So I wasn't actually very keen to be like a full-time composer, but of course I was doing it for a while. And then I finally like got cast in Talash and
right.
had a bit of a, like an acting career start after that, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
We got married, Shruti and I got married in like 2017.
Mm-hmm.
And it was one of those things where, you know, Shruti was big part of like encouraging me to like do it for real. She said, you know, you're always writing these songs, you're always talking about, you know, you're writing, your songs are great and all that, you know, it, do something, you know, with it. And it was kind of a conversation like that, that sort of, you know, got me thinking. I was a, you know, a man getting married. So what kind of man am I? You know, all those kinds of things and all these songs, do something with the songs. And then I started doing things with the songs, you know, and I did a few solo gigs and then I put the band together a couple of 2-3 months after I did my first solo gig. And we actually haven't played in a while because of the lockdown and all that stuff. But we are going to, we're working on an album basically. So a full length album is, but probably the next thing you're going to hear from the band, and then we'll see about live gigs and all that, you know, as and when it comes.
It's never too late to follow something which you feel passionate about, and that stands true here as well. So best of luck and best wishes. Looking forward to that album coming out. Can we expect it in 2021 itself, or is it going to take a while?
It's a very good question. If everything, it really depends how busy I get. I mean, if there's my woman season 2 happening, then who knows, you know, my life is a bit like that, you know, it's when I need time and only time and my own time for music, but I'm going to do jobs when they come, you know,
of course,
it's a bit like that. Yeah.
That's absolutely perfect. Now, whom do you consider yourself to be in, if you have to put yourself in this order, out of these three? It's a singer, writer, actor. So how would you prioritize yourself to be?
To the world, it's actor, writer, singer. To myself, it's writer, something else, actor. Okay. I mean, something else I'm saying because, I mean, basically like, by education, I'm a filmmaker, you know, so that's very much like something that I want to do.
Okay.
I think, you know, made a few like steps in that direction. Uh-huh. But of course, I need a lot more steps and do it in a more concerted way to really like make it happen.
Perfect. So before we move on to the last segment of this chat, Hemant, your character in The Married Woman, is genuinely a nice guy. He cares about his wife. He makes sure she's safe. Even in 90s, the show is based early 90s, and the time was, the society was way more patriarchal than it is now. Couple of instances towards the latter half of the show, there are those scenes where it is being portrayed where you, the audience, will hate him because the way he speaks, the way he says, and the way he's acting towards his wife. Mentally, how do you prep yourself, or what is your thought process to portray a character in that zone when you want audience to hate this part of this character, hate this side of this character?
Yeah, so I don't think I want the audience to like hate Hemant, or for that matter, like, you know, hate any character I'm playing in this, in one scene or whatever. I don't think that's what I'm looking for or thinking or doing. Okay. I'm thinking that I want everybody to understand Hemant, you know, so that's kind of what I'm thinking, and then my job is to express Hemant as clearly as I can. You know, so, and really, like, you know, this is where Hemant's coming from, and yes, you know, in that scene or whatever, Hemant is pissed, he's angry, and like a lot of angry people are saying very horrible things, very hurtful things, you know, that he probably wouldn't say if he wasn't so angry, you know. And I think that's just like what's happening. And a lot of men would be like, you know, would understand Hemant completely
100%.
And be like, that wife character, she doesn't get it. She doesn't get it how hard it is for Hemant.
Right.
Being stuck between like parents and wife and all that, you know, being progressive, but still being anchored, providing, forgetting whatever you want to be in life, then making sure your kids are set for life, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, who understands that pressure? And I think a lot of men watching that would be like, you know, nobody gets that, you know, you know, the man is like the unsung hero. And I think it was like that, you know, like for me, Hemant is kind of like an unsung hero, except that like he looks like the villain because that's just how the story is, you know, and you will end up being the villain of like someone's story because you need to be your own hero, you know. It's a bit like that.
Very, very well put, actually. That summarizes it quite well. Now, we have a quick game to understand a bit more about yourself, your likes and dislikes.
Yeah? Sure. Okay.
Great. Play. Sounds good. So the first one is, when not working on a project, like it's completely your off day, what is Suhas most likely to be doing?
Tending to his Cocker Spaniel, his very needy Cocker Spaniel.
That's
who just like wants me there all the time. He doesn't want me to be away from him at all. So I'm just going to be there and like pamper him and spoil him. That's what
lovely.
I do.
Lovely. Yeah. Name any of your one top most favorite movie or movies.
So many. quickly, Wayne's World.
Mm.
Nice. Yeah, have you seen it?
Lovely. I have, long time ago.
Yeah, it's
quite good. Yeah. Lovely. Favorite series, but in this one, I need like a name from Indian sector and international sector.
Well, I mean, recently I saw Bombay Vegam Jatha. That was really good. I really liked it.
Nice.
Internationally, I mean, I always tell this to people, but there's a show called The Wire, an HBO show called The Wire.
Yes.
Which I think is just the best like TV show, you know, of all time, and everybody should watch it to know what like can happen in a TV show, in a web series or whatever.
Yeah. Any favorite song, Hindi and English?
Oh, I mean, so many options. Now you want me to just like, I don't know, so many Hindi songs. Oh, Haseena Zulfon Wali.
Wow.
From PC Munsil, you know, great song. I love it. Favorite English song. I mean, just that we're listening to music like all the time. You know, in my house, there's like music every day in the morning while we're getting the, you know, taking our dog, preparing him for his walk and all that stuff. So Come and Get Your Love by Redbone.
Nice.
Yeah, it's one of like me and my wife, like one of our songs.
Oh, beautiful. Yeah. Beautiful. Yeah. A director or a couple of directors whom you've not worked with so far, but would like to collaborate in future projects?
I admire Vishal Bhardwaj a lot. You know, I don't know if he'll ever cast me, because looking at the, you know, the films he makes, he might just look at me and be like, "Ise ho payega kya?" Whatever, you know. But I think he's a great storyteller, and like he's just so talented that I would love to like be on a, you know, one of his film sets. Abroad, of course, like, you know, Martin Scorsese. I mean. Oh. Of course, why not?
All right. One thing you're scared of?
Laziness, you know, time going by and me not having done enough. It's a fear.
Nice, but honest. Three things you can't live without. Materialistic stuff.
My guitar.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I guess it's all like music related, because I would say like guitar and computers, like my, you know, my audio workstation basically.
Yeah.
So a microphone. It's just like it's all music related.
that's absolutely fine. Three fun facts or weird facts which you would like the world to know about you.
I make the world's best masala dosa and sambar.
Wow.
Coconut chutney. Basically, it, like over the lockdown, started like, you know, working on this, and by the end, I was just like really good. I can like roll up the dosas and like, you know, present like cylindrically rolled dosas.
Fantastic.
I would love to play ultimate frisbee in like a hilly area.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. I like coffee. I like black coffee, and I try not to drink too much of it. But there's this line from a show called Twin Peaks, where the protagonist is asked like how he would like his coffee, and he says, "Black as midnight on a moonless night." So that's how I like my coffee. Yeah.
Fantastic. Now, I'll remember this line for sure. Great. So that was the game. Thank you so much for being honest, firstly. It was really fun to get to know a little bit more about you as an individual. Any projects you're working on which you can officially share, where we can see you next on screen, off screen? No?
Yeah. So no. So I can't say anything officially. And also, you know how it is. You know, one of the few things that I'm like superstitious about, you know,
fair enough.
Like, don't tell anybody. Until you're doing something until you sign the contract, and then until you like show up at the shoot until shoot is over,
yeah.
until marketing begins. When marketing begins,
is
that's
the
when I like
confirmed.
People.
Fair enough.
Yeah,
absolutely.
That's when I tell you.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
No problem with that. We wish you all the very, very best. Thank you so much for taking out the time. And we are looking forward to two things now. Your album coming up, fingers crossed, 2021. And your more on-screen projects as well.
Yes.
Yeah.
And maybe a Married Woman season 2.
Definitely. Wo aa raha hai sir. Pakka aa raha hai wo. I'm
yeah,
pretty sure.
Yeah. yeah, it should be like a 2022 thing maybe.
Yeah.
But it's going to happen. You know?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Thank you so very much for taking all the time. It was a pleasure speaking with you.
Likewise, sir. Thank you.
Thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed this. Make sure to like and share this video with your friends and family. Do not forget to subscribe to Binge Buddies for more such candid conversations.